Yes, sir. All right, good morning to all our listeners out radio, man. We're going to say call a friend. Call a neighbor, let them know the the program is on the air this morning. That's right, your grace and mercy, Brother Claude. We're still praying for you this morning. And again, we want to say good morning to all our listeners in radio land. We do have a councilman that made his round all the way from Washington, D.C., done made his round back to Jackson, Mississippi. So he's here this morning to let you know what's going on. And now we're going to Councilman Stokes, and he's going to give us a prayer or a scripture. Good morning, Councilman.
Good morning.
All right.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Prayer. Heavenly Father, once again, we come to say thank you. Thank you for being so good to us. Thank you, dear Lord, for taking us up and down these byways and highways. Dear Lord, please stop by the jailhouses. Stop by the nursing homes. Stop by the hospitals. Please stop by the prisons. Let your children know that you're God all by yourself. Dear Lord, thank you for Dr. Williams. Reverend Dr. Williams, we got the church anniversary today. We thank you for that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, Doctor.
We thank you for Reverend Dr. Lewis, who had a vision.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for his brother, Jabbo.
Yes,
Reverend
sir.
Reverend Dr. Lewis, new Jabbo.
That's right.
Dear Lord, please, thank you, Lord. Please,
thank you.
Stop in Jackson, all over the United States of America. Let them know. Let them know, God, that you're in the blessing business. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for my wife and giving us strength and the family for coming in and visiting during spring break. Dear Lord, again, bless all your children. Bless all your people. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. Thank you, Councilman. Thank you once again. Thank you for that prayer. And again, we said prayers always and all. And again, we just thank you, Lord, that he gave you all traveling drapes all the way to Washington and gave you traveling drapes back home. And when you got back home, you found everything well. And we want to tell him just thank you because he didn't have to do it, Councilman. So we want to just say thank you. And we're saying good morning to all our listeners out in radio land and to Judge Stokes. Good morning, Judge. Good morning. Don't cook the big boy nothing.
Give him some soup.
All right, we want to say good morning to you just tuning in. That's right, Councilman Stokes is back. And again, we want to just say good morning. We want to say good morning to the DA, Robert Chula Smith. I want to say good morning to his lovely mother, Dr. Alice Smith, Dr. Roy Smith. Good morning.
Amen.
We hope y'all fine over there, Ms. Smith, this morning. We continue to pray for you. And again, we thank you, and Council, I know you've been out of town, but we found out again that they done set the date for the DA back into September. We're supposed to be going starting tomorrow. So the DA is ready to go, but they set it up to back to September. So we're going to just be praying for him because, you know, there's so much going on. And Councilman, when you get the position now, if you don't do what they want to do you to do, they're going to always be on you. So we just got to keep fighting and praying for him and, again, for his entire family.
Well, Rev, you know the district attorney is he's a strong Christian young man.
That's right.
Who's not afraid. Now, Mama, I know it hurt, baby. I know my mommies tell me all the time, you know, what they do to you, it hurt me two or three times worse. But let me tell you this, Mama. You keep your head in God's hand, everything gonna be all right. Now, the people who should be complaining, the poor people, see, they only want to do the district attorney this way. He's the only district attorney they've done in this manner in the whole state of Mississippi since it's been a state of Mississippi, simply because he's black. See, they want to put everybody black in jail, whether guilty or not guilty. They want to put him in jail. He ain't going to do it. He wasn't raised like that. He's not going to put an innocent man in jail because somebody wants him to be guilty. What about them big dope boys? They won't mess with them. They won't touch them. What about them big boys who are doing all this stealing? They won't touch them. Them white boys bringing all this dope in here. They bringing all this crime in here. Ain't nobody saying a thing about them. Ain't nobody touching them. But that little bitty poor kid who might have a mental problem, oh, they won't put them under the jail. But they don't put white folks in jail. And that ain't right.
All right, you said it, but you know, we got to learn to deal with them and work with them and know the game that they play, Councilman, and let them know that, look, we just going to stay out here fighting and tell them what's going on. There are those that don't understand, and we got I have a problem with a lot of these black folks. They turning on us, and then doctor, they talk about you instead of trying to help you. They're talking about you. So we need to make sure that we get together with one another, and because what they do, they get in the room, they meet in the room someplace that we can't go, counsel. Mm. They ain't gonna let you in some of the meetings that they having, and they gonna talk about you, and they gonna talk about Reverend Will. Then when they come out, they already know what's going on. So that's why we got to keep fighting. We've been saying that over the year. We have disagreement with one another. Let's get together and find out what's going on, and then we can move farther. Because I tell you what, you can disagree with your wife, but I guarantee you, you ain't gonna never leave her. Amen. Y'all was trying to straighten that thing out. Somebody
let's straighten it, Lanamo.
Yeah, that's what it was. See, now, Kenny, you ain't got no better knowing about Lanamo. Talking about straightening it out. That's why he said, let's straighten it out. Well, that's what we got to do. We got to work together as a black race and make sure we get together and get this thing on the right track and continue to move. Count on.
Well, Red, we got to say this, and we're going to get to it. We got to guess and everything else, but I just don't want the DA or his family to feel they out here on the battlefield by themselves.
That's right.
You know, it's so easy to think that and nobody care. And I'm telling you, Mama, and I'm telling you, Mr. DA, the only thing they wanted you to do is put a whole lot of black folks in jail. Now, people complain, and that's why they said, why just us getting arrested? We need somebody. Now, Ed Peter sit there and treated black people like a dog and did everybody else. They ain't done nothing here. He's still out here walking free. But then when you start thinking about Ben Allen, and you think about what did they do to Ben Allen when he did something wrong. Well, this district attorney, he thought enough of the law. That he prosecuted Ben Allen. He said, you might be white, you might have a lot of money, have all the business community behind you, but you are not above the law. And if we can prosecute and put these poor black people in jail, then we can put white people in jail too. They found him guilty. He's still there running, we still call it CCI. That's what it started off as, Capital City Incorporated. Making over $150,000. A convicted felon. Now, you find a black convicted felon that's going to have that kind of job and that kind of money coming in and everything, and I buy you an old regular car because they ain't going to do it. This man went after white, collar crime, just like they do black. And that's why they're trying to tan him down. But, Mama, y'all keep your hand in God's hand.
All right, you said it, so we got to keep on, keep on fighting, and again, they keep putting it up, like I said, they don't have no evidence, and again, we know that, so we got to fight, keep fighting. We kept saying, old Stanley, he lost in every fight, and he wouldn't even show up at the other trial. He had them other people down there trying to defend the case, and they said, well, Stanley got it, they said, where's Stanley at? Say he ain't showing up, man. So that's why we got to keep fighting. Because you know what, Councilman? It's at the DA time now, but it could be out before the sun go down. So that's why we got to keep fighting for our
people. So the trial is not going to be on tomorrow?
Not going to be on tomorrow, and the DA was ready to go in the morning. He got all this stuff, he was ready to go. And they come up and found a phone and saying they need to look at it. Now you know good and well that you can go in there and get your phone number taken out in 30 seconds. We're just going to be praying. The Lord working in mysterious ways, Councilman. So we just got to keep fighting and putting it in his hand. And we know everything's going to be all right. Councilman?
All right. Well, Red, we got a guest in the house. We got the man in the house. We got the man. Mr. Man, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. Pleasure to be here with you, gentlemen. Pleasure to speak with your listening audience. Look forward to talking about the state of the city. Look forward to talking about the idea of how we work together in order to move the city forward. And in doing so, we have to have honest and true narratives. And so when I'm called a liar, then I want to make certain that we can come before each other and tell me why I'm a liar. I want to know how we move the city forward and do it for the benefit of all people, and especially when we know black people are dealing with so many things. We're talking about the district attorney this morning and talking about everything that he's faced. Well, you know, I thought it was so important to stand up for the brother at a time where most people told me that I should not do it. I was in the middle of a campaign, and people say, well, you got to think about how it affects your campaign. And I stood when when no other politician was standing in order to have a press conference and fight for him. And so we got to stand on principle, and we got to have truthful discussion about how we move this city forward. And if we can hold each other to account, we can make sure that we're doing what we need to do. But we got to be clear. If you say that your brother's a liar, then you got to tell your brother why he's a liar.
Okay. I don't remember calling you a liar, Mr. Webb, but I did say we need Harvey Johnson. Mm-hmm. And I stand by that. And the reason I said we need Harvey Johnson is because we got to get someone to make sure that this city is not going to go in the wrong direction in terms of giving the governor opportunity to take over the city. Now, when Harvey Johnson left the city of Jackson, the city of Jackson, I would imagine, had $20 to $30 million. In the water department, we probably had $60 million. And all those numbers are gone. Now, I know you haven't been there long enough for it to be gone, and I know some of this is going to go on y'all. But you got to get someone who understands what's going on, where we are, and what's going to happen. Now, if we don't get somebody like Harvey Johnson who got true knowledge, we got to get somebody like Louis Armstrong who knew and know what to do. Even when Frank Melton came in, he brought Robert Walker. Now, everybody knew Frank Melton was fighting crime, and Robert Walker was running the city. We got to have that kind of 1-2 punch. If this governor, King, if we miss one note of paying some debt, and this governor have the opportunity to come into Jackson, he's going to take it over.
Yeah, I appreciate your statement. But if we really, engage in a truthful narrative, then if you want to talk about the water billing issues, it is directly connected to Siemens. And you say you want Harvey Johnson. Harvey Johnson is the one who issued the Siemens contract. And so we can't, I don't see how that even makes sense. And so what we're trying to do is make certain that we hold the contract that we now have been dealt, hold it accountable. And so being in office for 8 months for an issue that people have been seeing and complaining about for the last 2 to 3 years, it is ridiculous to put that notion on me. And so I'm making every effort to change that. And so what I want to see, if we're talking about that, then we got to make sure we're fully committed. We got to make sure that we're fully engaged. And when I'm working on these issues each and every day, when we have work sessions, when we have these meetings, when we have opportunities to discuss with each other, you need to be fully committed like I am to talk to me so that we can work through these things instead of putting issues that you in your own, in every reasonable account, you can't say is on me. You know that I didn't sign any Siemens contract. You know I'm dealing with the hand that I was dealt, and we're going to work with that. We're not going to complain. We took this job because we're serious about it, and we know that we can work through it. When we talk about issues of crime, we're moving forward with a positive change. When we look at the issues that the police are dealing with, let's talk about my history and what I fought for people. Right here on this street, I was here when Johnny Griffin was shot down, and we stood for his family. I was here when Andre Jones hung from a Mississippi jail, and we stood for him. I've been here representing the family of Rexdale Henry, who was killed in the Neshoba County Jail. I was here representing the family of Jonathan Sanders, who was choked to death by a police officer. I have stood in rooms after autopsy, looking at the bodies of family members, because they were questioning whether it was based on police brutality. Right down the street, right around the corner from you, I've been here with the Malcolm X Center doing day camps and doing all of these things for people. So my commitment is longstanding, all the way from childhood to adulthood. And so to question those things, when we're talking about crime, when we're talking about how we keep people to account, my commitment can be unchallenged. And we got to make certain that we match that. There are some people that like to be seen and heard, and there are those people who like to be effective. And I'm the effective type. And so I want to make sure that we work together. I find it disappointing that you and I haven't worked together better than this. You're somebody that I have grown up seeing the things that you speak up against. And so I want to make sure that the commitment that we share equals some of those things that we've talked about historically. And so that's why when I'm called out, you got to know that I'm going to show up because I've always shown up.
Well, Mr. Mayor, and we thank you for the things you're saying, but you know, and I know, and the Griffin family know that Kenny Stoles is right there with Johnny Griffin, with your father.
I didn't say that you weren't. In terms of Seamus,
now Harvey Johnson may have made that effort because of other people, but the budget issues that we're facing in the city of Jackson today, we did not face them with Harvey Johnson.
The bills were paid.
There was no situation where right now we got these balloons facing us where the governor can get involved.
Well, first and foremost, that hasn't come under me. We're not going to hold
Harvey Johnson, who was there maybe 12 years, for maybe one bad decision. What I'm saying is that if you got this kind of leadership, if you got this kind of internal knowledge, let's use it. And Harvey Johnson not somebody Kenny Stoles go out and drink a beer with or eat dinner. We don't do none of those kind of things. I'm just saying what's right. Now, the next thing I said, we need Rick Hill. Now, Rick Hill knew where all the money was, where the body's buried. We didn't have these kind of things. Let's go get somebody so we can get this train on the right track. Let's get Rick Hill back involved. Let's find out how and where do we go from here. Now, it sounds good what you're saying. You were there at this, you were there at that. But, Mr. Mayor, I'm not taking up for Yarber. Yarber came in at a bad time. I said from the beginning that Yarber shouldn't have taken. They should have given you the position. Give you a chance to see could you do it. Then let's have an election. But these streets, Mr. Mayor, in our neighborhoods, the word is not offered. Then I go down Ridgewood Road. They got a sign, your 1% working for you. What about Mega Evans Boulevard? What about Baylor Avenue? What about Ellis Avenue? All the black neighborhoods, we ain't doing but paying the 1%. We ain't getting absolutely nothing.
I'm glad that you brought that up, Councilman, because I can talk about, first and foremost, I haven't made one decision on a road to be paved since I've been in office. That came prior to me. I'm going to go to the issue of the roads. But the issue with the finances come directly from past leadership. I didn't set up the finances to where they are. These are bond debts that are coming due now. If you borrow money, then at some point you're going to have to pay it back. And so all the money that's been borrowed...
This is your budget, Mr. Mayor.
And I'm staying within my budget.
If this was coming due, you the mayor, you got to be ready to have this done during the budget process.
I'm glad you mentioned the budget process. Let's get Rick Hill so we'll be ready. We met for 2 months on a budget. And you didn't come to any of the budget hearings. And so that's important.
I really don't want to be on the budget committee. And I really say I'm not on the budget committee. Well, but I'm going to be at the meeting where we vote.
All right,
well, I have not missed a vote on the budget.
Okay,
I'm not on any budget committee or other committees.
Okay, let me address the other issue. We'll just let that slide right now. But when you say that no roads have been paved in Ward 3, first and foremost, we recently had the breaking ground on the largest infrastructure project in the city's history that runs through your ward, but yet you weren't there.
It runs through my ward.
Yes,
but it's not totally in my ward.
Not exclusively,
but it's really for the white folks around Fundren. That's who it's for.
No.
It's for the white folks around Fundren because that's where the work going to be done on State Street.
Where this is dead in the center of the black community. Dead in the center. And it's going to help Tougaloo. How many white folks you know live in the Tougaloo community?
How many black folks live in Fundren?
Okay. First and foremost, there's plenty.
They're already working on Fundren. That's who's making the money for Fundren.
Let's talk about Ward 3. This is what the 1% on Cleary Street between Dalton and Dead End. There's been 1% dollars spent there.
How many houses on Clover Hill Drive? That's right there behind Jackson State. No houses.
Can I speak to all?
No houses. That's what I'm saying, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, what I'm saying is, ain't no houses on Clover Street. Why couldn't you do a street where people are? Why not Bain Avenue?
On Eminence Row. These are the places, and I'm not saying that this is enough. But I'm telling you what they've done. This isn't even the decisions that I've made because I hadn't had that chance.
Because we didn't get no input on that.
On Fontaine Avenue, on Greenfield Avenue, from Skyline to Redwood Avenue, on
Bale Avenue,
on Lampton Avenue, on
Lance Boulevard,
on you know, Robin Hill Road on Rutledge Drive. All these are areas where work has been done on Brook Hollow Drive. Well, that's not in your ward.
I know.
On Segura. There have been equally as many roads in Ward 3 as any other place in the city. And that's not to say that I agree with it. But the point is, I haven't made one of these decisions. These are all things that came from
the president. I didn't make any of those decisions.
Okay, but when you...
Who made the decision?
When you put it on me, when you say that you need Harvey Johnson,
Who made the decision, Mr. Brown? This came under the last administration.
That's when these roads were approved.
So, ain't a single house on Clary Street. That's right there behind Jackson
State. Well, you're going to have to talk to somebody.
You brought it up, Mr. Man. I just want to make sure it's
the
clear.
The point that I made.
Would I have suggested Clary Street where there's no houses, but you go down Bailey Avenue, you dodge a pothole?
Maybe.
You better not try to go down Monument by the railroad track. You have to get in the other lane.
And I agree that those areas need to be addressed. And that's what I'm fighting
for. But we're paying that 1%.
I agree that there should have never been a commission to begin with. But I have to be given the opportunity to illustrate what roads need to be done. I haven't dictated one road to be paved based on the 1% yet. This was all put under the past administration and it's paved under...
So you said all of this is y'all's fault?
I'm saying that I haven't made one decision on these roads.
All right. Now, I went to the same law school you did long before you did. Now.
Okay, absolutely. All right. Absolutely. All right. So you proved me wrong.
All right.
You proved me wrong. Have you been to one of the 1% meetings?
Let me say this, Mr.
Mayor. I had them recorded so you can look at the recording.
I went for 1%, and I don't go to their meetings.
Okay.
Number one, Now, I wasn't even for when they came up with this because you brought it up several times, the meeting for the meeting. That's what we called it. That's when they try to find out how you think. You call it work session. Well, work taking place there. I don't go to that.
Well,
I go to council meeting.
The work
now, when the white folks was in charge, they didn't have none of this nonsense. I was there when the white folks was in charge. You came to council meeting.
Well, let's talk about let's talk about where we work. When I met with Grove Park community on the golf course, and I sat down there, you weren't there. When we had the meeting, was that my meeting,
Mr. Mayor, or was that your meeting?
Well, it was my meeting, but...
Oh, okay, but you don't come to my meeting.
I've been to your meetings that you've invited me to. The meetings you've invited me to, I've come to.
So you invited me to Grove Park?
Yes, I invited you to Grove Park.
How?
I told you in council that we were having the meeting with the community.
Mr. Mayor, you're a government man. You give me a memo, something in writing, where I know I'm invited. Because if I'm not there, I send my people there.
Kenny, there have been many times. Whenever you've invited me to something, I've come. Whenever you've invited me. And I will always make that commitment. When we had the Malcolm X Center here for 10 years, never saw you in the Malcolm X Center. So don't act like we don't show up, brother. It's important
Mr. Mack, how are you going to have the Malcolm X Center? I hope you're talking about the one that was up on Martin Luther King.
That's the one I was talking about.
And you're going to tell me I wasn't ever there. I was there when you weren't there. How you think Miss Thompson them let you in that building? Ain't nothing coming through my ward and my zone without me and my people knowing something about her being there.
The point is.
So if you didn't see me there, don't sit up here and say I was never there.
Well, I got people.
I was there with your dad when you wasn't there.
Okay.
And we can go deeper than that. When I'm at the cemetery putting flowers on the grave, I'm the same one putting flowers on your mother and father's grave.
And I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
Well, I just want to keep the record straight, man.
But don't tell me that I'm not committed. Don't tell me.
If you're going to get defensive,
all right, we got about 1 minute
that Harvey Johnson needs to be
on this side, Kelsey.
That's not right. Okay.
No.
We're going on. We're going to get back.
Yeah, we're going to get back.
Yeah, your granddad, Rita, Keith, Melissa, Kashawn, Keisha, Robin, Roman. Kanita, Wolfa, Ray, Deborah, Bob, and Daddy, we gotta go. Bye-bye.
All right, don't move that down. We're gonna be back on the other side of News and Beat. We got the mayor in the house, the Councilman Stokes, we's in the house, and again, we're gonna be coming back letting you know what's going on.
We got
enough
30 minutes.
I'll be here. Thank you.
Good morning, good morning, Brother Claude. How you doing this time, son? Hold it on. Let them know. Call them. Tell them, look, man, you need to go take you a little break now. Take a break. And again, because it's going to be going on. Me and you both is going on, Brother Claude. Somebody going to push it, brother. So we got to stay prayed up with. But Sister Claude, keep eyes on the baby. All right, saying good morning once again. Now, we just come out of Grace and Mercy. And you know it's already been warm, so we're going to keep it going on. You know, Grace and Mercy is going to be on either side. But we kick it off this morning. And again, we got the mayor in the house. We got the councilman in the house. And we got Reverend William in the house. And again, while we got the mic open, we want to remind everybody now, today is the day.
3 o'clock.
The day of the day calendar, 3 o'clock. We'll be celebrating 26 years right here on this corner. That's right. Being flooded out, being broken in. That's right. We've seen them come and we've seen them go. So we want to just thank the Lord for staying here. And the late Reverend L.H. Deuce, as we said earlier, he's seen a vision. He said the Lord sent him back from Toledo, Ohio, to build a church and start a church. And he started this church. He had a vision, and all of his vision that he seen in his time that the Lord let him see. He did not see him vision, but Reverend Wee was able to see what he had seen come about. So we have had all kinds of people come through here.
Amen.
And we want to just thank you, Councilman Stokes, for being with us over these 26 years. And talking about you today, you will be a handling the business, and we're going to be broadcasting live right here, 103.5 and 1300 AM right here at 3 o'clock. And so somebody up there, y'all be ready at 3 now to make sure you get counting home at 3 o'clock, all right? So today at 3, we're going to be right here, and Pastor Tre'Trell Pate, singer, preacher, musician, and a teacher, he's going to be here. We got a lot of guests on their way here to be with us this afternoon to help celebrate these 26 years. Counselor, we're going back to you as a scripture out prayer.
We're going to do a Bible verse.
All right.
We're going to go to Genesis chapter 1, verse 3. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Amen.
All right. Thank you for that Bible verse, Councilman. All right, we're going to get ready to move right along. We're going to get ready to move right along. And again, we want to just thank everyone that hit us up on Facebook this morning, which comment. We want to just say good morning to you. And Councilman, we're here this morning. We're here to try to straighten out and get some questions answered that we need to answer. Only way we can get them out, we got to come together and ask these questions. That's right. And again, we're going to be fighting and finding out what's going on. And again, understanding of what is going on. So we just want to continue to work together with one another, find out what's going on. We want to say, Councilman, we want to thank you so very much for standing in with us this afternoon to be a part of this church anniversary. And again, we want to say to the councilman meeting, and sometime we had to go back in the back room and iron out some of our stuff because we got to make sure we treat each and everyone right. And Mr. Tim, you know, I respect you now, son, but I see you messing around with those stamps down there. You ain't do those stamps right now, Mr. Tim, and I know you're getting old like Charles Ever, but man need to speak, let him speak. Don't wait till that other guy sitting on the other end tell you let him speak. Let him speak.
Let him speak.
Now, you
what
know,
you trying to say?
Yeah, you know.
We got the mayor here, and we got to show courage, and we're going to let it go to the mayor. So this is the last part of the show. We're going to make sure you get all the points in.
Okay.
Well, I appreciate that. This is what I would say. We have to engage in honest narratives so that people know the truth about what is the wrong with the city. And we have to work collectively in order to improve the city. My hope is that we can start working together, is that we can put petty differences aside in order for the benefit of the citizens of Jackson. The citizens of Jackson voted overwhelmingly for a new direction. They voted overwhelmingly that we move in a new direction, and I'm committed to that. I'm committed to that for all parts of the city, as my history has demonstrated. And so I would say to you, I would leave with this scripture. Matthew 18, verses 21 through 22 says, then Peter came unto him and said, Lord, how ought shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say unto thee, until seven times, not until seven times, but until 77 times. So that means that we have to be willing to forgive one another time and time again. And so when I think that there have been mistruths given about me, then I think it's important that I set the record straight, because I want the citizens of Jackson to know that we are fully committed to all of them. I want them to know that we have not been discriminatory. I have made no decision on any road. When we talk about the finances, I need people to know that the can has been kicked down the road for so long that we inherit an issue with the budget. And so we have to work together for these issues. Because at the end of the day, if we don't figure out a way to resolve this, then the next mayor won't look like you or I. Then the council won't look like you or I. And the people who are going to suffer as a result will look like you and I. And so I'm committed to that, as my life has demonstrated. I appreciate you, brother, for the work that you've done. And I'm saying that we have to dig a little deeper and push a little harder in order to make certain that we change the city. I appreciate the relationship that you had with my dad, and I appreciate the love that you've shown my parents in putting roses on their grave. But I would submit to you, the best way to honor my parents is to work with their son that they left here to do the work. Because I believe, through my work, that is how Shokwe and Nubia Lumumba lives. They will live on forever in the people's struggle. And so I continue to struggle on behalf of oppressed people worldwide. I continue to fight on behalf of the citizens of Jackson. And I will make certain that I put the best, brightest, and most dedicated people in place in order to fight for this city, because I believe that this city deserves the best. I love this city. The best decision my parents ever made was moving to Jackson, Mississippi. And so that's what my commitment is. And I extend a hand to you, my brother, that we work together and that we work for the benefit of this city so that everyone walks out more blessed and more prosperous for it.
Mr. Mayor, we thank you so much for that. And, you know, in the spirit of goodwill, a suggestion, and it's not in the wrong direction, have a conversation with Harvey Johnson. I'm not saying you got to follow his direction and lead. Have a conversation with Louis Armstrong. These people got knowledge that can help this city go where it need to go. Have a conversation with E.C. Foster. You know, it's so many people that you should and could talk to who would make things better. Now, let me go to this thing about the border. We got, from what you had at the meetings, and I don't have any memos to show that, we got 15,000 people. 15,000 not receiving water bills. And we got a couple of big notes coming up. My suggestion, let's use some, let's go back and use meter readers. You're saying, your office saying, now we're going to get Siemens straightened out. Well, suppose they don't straighten it out. Meter readers worked. Even if you do Siemens later, let's bring money in now if we got to meet those notes. Let's go back to meter readers so people get their bills. People want to pay the bills. A lot of people who not getting these bills stopping me at the store and other place. I need a bill. I ain't got a bill in such and such a long time. Why I ain't got a bill? If we put meter readers back out here, while we got this crisis, then we can, the money that could be generated from them 15,000. I'm not saying that every one of those 15,000 people going to pay. But at least we can get half. We can be down the road and trying to solve this problem. We got to try to go back. Everything that was old is not bad. Meter readers was old. I know we're in this new technology era where we're going to do everything technology, but it's not working.
Yeah, I would agree that the system has failed. I'm not the one who took the meter readers off the street to begin with.
But you can put them back.
That decision was made by Harvey Johnson.
But you can put them back.
Let me say this. I am committed to doing whatever it takes to get the issue resolved, whether it be by meter readers or whether the experts tell me that that's not going to do it, then we will exhaust and leave no stone unturned in order to resolve this issue. That is my commitment. So if it becomes meter readers, then so be it. But in terms of seeking advice, what I am, my brother, is a student of history. I have been around since, the reason you know me is because I've been around since I was a little boy. So I admire and I learn from my elders. I do talk to Harvey Johnson. on the issue when it came to the school system. I talked to Harvey Johnson, and he offered his support in that regard. I just gave, I presented Harvey Johnson with an award during Black History just a few weeks ago. And so I don't have a problem with talking to anybody. And I'm always open to any discussion. And I want you to understand that, that any conversation you want to have with me, you can have it with me. When you talk about the reason that you don't want to go to work sessions.
Don't want to go.
Let me say, the reason, whatever you want to say about it, that is immaterial to me. Whether you go or not is your decision, but you still have the availability to call me and talk through issues. Just like when I was about to make a decision, I've shown up on your porch in order to talk to you about it, in order to say, listen, this is what the problem that I'm having. And so that is always available. And so we have to make sure that our commitment is to the betterment of the citizens of Jackson. And that's what my commitment is.
Well, Mr. Mayor, and this is and just us talking directly with each other. It's one thing
with
to
a few hundred thousand people listening.
It's another thing to talk with people.
Okay.
I'm saying, if you had a conversation with Harvey Johnson, it's got to be not talking at him. It's got to be talking with Mr. Mayor. These kind of situations he's in right now. What would you do? And then just weigh it. Even if you say Robert Walker, who was with Frank Melton. But we can't sit here and see that the train is in reverse, coming off the track. And then we sit here and say, well, we're going to say what the experts saying we need to do. These experts might be wrong.
And that's why I said, whatever we have to do, we'll figure it out. And I, you hadn't been privy to Harvey and my conversation, so you don't know about anybody talking at anybody. I don't talk with anybody. I talk with people. And so I thank Harvey for his wisdom. I thank Harvey for what he has to offer. But at the same time, I will learn from Harvey, and I will also apply the things that I understand to the circumstance. The people did not vote for us to go back, you know, to pass leadership, even though I believe we can learn from it. The people voted for us to move in a new direction. And so I think that we can work together, old and young, right? Meaning old regime and the new leadership, in order to find the solutions. I believe in collective genius. I believe that we are a lot smarter together than we are independently. And so that is me saying to you, Kenny, my hope and my prayer and my excitement when I took office was that, hey, I get an opportunity to sit down with this brother who's been here for 30 plus years working for the city of Jackson. And I can take from him what he understands. And I can also apply some things that move us into a new era. I can offer some things. I can offer my suggestion to how we move the city forward. And that's what my commitment is, whether it be you, whether it be Harvey, whether it be past directors in any particular department, I'm always open to learn. And that's who I am. That's who my commitment is. The reason that my father said that he thought this was a better position for me than it was for him is because he witnessed somebody who was willing to learn. He witnessed somebody who was committed to this struggle and committed because I fell in love with the work that they did. And so that's where I stand. I'm always willing to learn from whomever. And so we're going to continue to do that. And I am going to, whether we have to, you know, whether we have to struggle to make it happen, I'm still committed to working with you, my brother.
So what Mayor Cunningham, what you're saying, Councilman saying, I agree with him somewhat about Harvey Johnson. Now, Harvey Johnson ought to be the one, if he was sitting right here, well, you sitting there, I'd tell him the same thing. If Harvey Johnson, if he don't know nothing about SEMA, then don't nobody know nothing about SEMA. I went to the city council meeting and asked them, do not go for a SEMA, because they were there. They went on, Mr. Tillman voted. Judge Stokes now, she was a councilman. Your father was a councilman. All of them was on the city council at the time. When SEMA come in, and Harvey, he thought that was a good idea. Frank Blunt and them all thought that was an idea. But some of the things that SEMA had, which you're not aware of, probably because you hadn't searched it up, some of the things that SEMA said they was going to do for the city of Jackson, they had not done in that $90 million, which they said when they got through.
How many million?
90 million. When they got through with the projects, when they got through with all of the software, everything, they were going to train somebody to turn over to how to control the board, how to read the meters out. Now they're trying to trick you into whoever holding the position now They trying to trick you into paying the money to get the software. They tell us we ain't got no software. Yeah. We can't read no meter. And that's my concern about in counseling as well. We're saying that we got to find out why SEMA don't have the meter, have it hooked up. They wouldn't pay, voted the poster, take them off the fire plug account, and put them on the pole because they said the fire plug didn't look good for the antenna to be on. But I hadn't found no antenna that could read a meter. So that's why we suggesting that also, as Kevin said, let's go out, get the meter readers out. Don't cost that much because the city don't pay the meter reader much money. We know that. They've been there for all their life. And let them get all the meter read up, and then they start paying the meters, and then go back to SEMA call. Seem like right now we're not gonna get no meters read for a while.
Let me say this. And I'm very well versed in the Siemens contract. There's some things that I won't say because you know I we never know where this thing may go. If you get where I'm going, we got you. In terms of the meter readers, first and foremost, we're not buying any more software than the city already bought, whether it was good or bad, right? I'm not saying that it was good or bad. But the cost is that we don't have the manpower in that regard that we used to have.
Well, you know, Mayor, now, former Mayor Yarbrough, I went to the meeting to tell him about reading. He was under compression and said in that meeting, we got to record, that we still had meter readers. Reading meters. We hadn't had a meter reader almost a year reading meters. So he was in the compression that we had meter readers still out because they didn't supposed to terminate the meter readers until everything was in play. So he terminated the meter readers. We don't have no meter readers to read our meters.
I didn't say that we didn't have any. We don't have enough manpower to do it the way that we need to do it. But we don't have.
They might say that we have meter readers will come out and check a meter once in a while. Because when I came downtown about 2 days later, another department, you wouldn't have met. Another department came out and read the meter. So, but we don't have meter readers, which only way you can get it back on level, you got to have manual meter reader. Because if I asked SEMA, we had a mini meeting with them right here in Cornerstone. They had the lock tops on the meters. I fought against that because North Jackson have them. And we had to have a special key to unlock them. If we had had those locks on our meter when we had the water crisis, everybody in Jackson would have had home flooded because the pipes bust was no way to cut them off. They came back right here at Cornerstone, got it on tape, that they said they were not going to use the lock meter. They're going to use the same tops that we have now, which you walk down the meter street. You'll see the same lead that was on there always. They just cut a hole in it, put the pipe in there, and that's supposed to be our meter to read our meter. So we're just concerned about that. And we got to some kind of way. You know, you can look into that. I know, like Cam Stowe said, we on different things, but something you have to, can't let them tell us that we can do that when it's hurting the citizen of Jackson.
This is how I feel. I don't trust what anybody tells me. I investigated myself. And what I said is my commitment is to do whatever's necessary to get the issue resolved. The issue is complicated. It is far more complicated than you know most of us really understand, and where I was later educated to it. But let me say this: you know, the reason that the meters are a problem has everything to do with the contract that was fulfilled, right? We talk about past leadership, and that was the problem because we never had a project manager from the city side, right? That wasn't put in the agreement, and so where Siemens was protected from their side, the city of Jackson was not. So the reason that you're able to have meters that are different on the west side than they are on the north side is because you had various contractors running out with nobody making certain that there was a uniform process, that every meter looked the same, that every pipe that went to those meters were the same. And so now you have a circumstance where you have 10 to 15 different pipes. Now you have a circumstance where some of the meters were supposed to be indoor meters, and they're actually being used as outdoor meters. And so you have meters that are going out. You have meters that are being flooded. You have meters that you know may not be able to send their signal because they're covered up by things. And so because we went to that system, it's become a problem over time. It's become a problem that has become more complicated by a bad contract that happened years ago. And so now we have to put all our minds together. We have to figure out how do we resolve the issue, and that's what my commitment is. And as I said, and I'll say it again, if it means that we have to hire more people to go out and be meter readers, then I'm committed to that. If it means that that's not the best solution, then I'm going to figure out what the best solution is that we resolve it, and that's what I'm going to do.
Fine, because I know we're slow to run out of time. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you heard about the meter reader, you heard about Siemens. We're going to police and the shootings now. And I know some of this on investigation. My suggestion, I know we said that we'll look at a police civilian review board, is body cameras. I think if we had body cameras, that a lot of the things, the concerns that citizens have and that the officers have could be addressed. I think body cameras would be the avenue to make sure that the relationship and the trust between the citizens and the police department would be enhanced. And I know some of the council members said these officers need raises, they don't need body cameras, and that's why I want to go to the Chamber of Commerce. And I hope that you'll go to the Chamber of Commerce, to the local chamber and the United States Chamber of Commerce, because Jackson, Mississippi is one of the few cities in the United States of America where there has been a positive relationship between police officers, the police department, and the city of Jackson. And that relationship is slowly becoming strained. Now, I don't know, I haven't met with the public yet to let them know I think that the suggestion of body cameras will help. I don't think that's going to stop police civilian review board. But we got to stop some of these officers who's acting in a way that's creating this fear, especially in the poor neighborhoods.
Well, let me say this. I have no objection to body cameras. The only question is we got to get to the money to pay for it, as you know. But I will say that I don't think body cameras is going to go far enough. The reason why I say that is because when we look around the country, in instances where there have been police brutality, many of those instances have been captured on TV. And there hasn't been a push to stop that stuff. And so I believe that we need to have a citizen review board. What has happened under this administration is a more thorough process. It used to be that the police department, once somebody was involved in an officer-involved shooting, then the police department could say to themselves, well, they're ready to come back to work and put them back on the job. Now what we have is a system where nobody is going to come back unless they are cleared by a grand jury. A grand jury in a city which is 85% black, which will be made up of people who look like the communities that are affected, that understand the unique dynamic between police and the community, historic dynamic. Furthermore, I want to present the opportunity, something I need to talk to the district attorney for, to make certain that the families feel that their voice is being heard in that grand jury process. Now, that is largely out of the mayor's hands. That deals with the district attorney, that deals with the county. And so I can't make any executive decisions to do that. But I think it's important. I think it's also important that we meet as a community to deal with the issue of crime, to deal with community policing so that we understand how we engage with it. I rattled off earlier in our last session about the history that I have on this issue, not only with Johnny Griffin's family and Griffith and Andre Jones' family and the Rexdale Henry family and the Jonathan Sanders family, all of these families that I represented, the countless number of clients that I've had on the issues of police brutality and just representing them in the criminal justice system. I don't take anybody's word, right? You'll never hear me say that I think our police are 100% right, because I don't know, right? First and foremost, I know too many circumstances where they haven't been right. And so what I say is that I need all of the facts. And so that's what I'm going to operate on. But at the same time, we need to make certain.
We're slow to run out of time.
Okay, I'm going to be
quick. The grand jury process that you're mentioning, it will be the DA's office handling that process?
Yes, DA. They always have a grand jury. DA always has the grand jury. So that is, I know at least one of those cases is already there. And I'm not saying, I don't know the facts well enough to say whether somebody acted appropriately or inappropriately. I want to see what comes of it. And I want the families to know that they can come and meet in my office. In fact, I'm extending the opportunity. I've talked to one of the attorneys already where they can come and share with me what they know and what they've seen. And we want to see an objective process, and that's what I'm committed to. Furthermore, the question about whether the officers are identified when they're involved in an officer-involved shooting, as I said in the press conference, it was an instance of first impression, and I didn't know. I wanted to investigate whether we do that. Well, I'm prepared to do an executive order on that issue, and that will be coming at a later time.
Now, let me say this. On last night, the news people, so you need to straighten that out if that's a lie. Mm-hmm. They will lie. The news people said last night now that the police department is sending it over to the grand jury, not to DA. So I believe the 16 News said that. I might be wrong. I don't want to call the wrong news person today. But that was a statement they made last night that the police. So we want to clarify that with the people that listen to us, because they listen to it, they're going to come back and ask.
Okay, but let me clarify how the process goes, mm-hmm. Okay? Any case is investigated by a law enforcement body. When that case is done, they hand it over to the DA's office, and the DA is the one that convenes a grand jury, right? So the DA presents all cases to a grand jury.
All right, now y'all heard that. So if y'all heard it last night on the news, like I heard it on that. Some of them the DA gonna have, and some of them the police. The mayor just told y'all that's not so.
And they have a grand jury. In terms of streets, man, we got 3 minutes. In terms of streets, most street pavement start in March and move on to April. They try to get through at least somewhere around late October. Do we foresee any of these? And I don't know if we're talking about 3% budget or what. We can put it all together, even the county helping. What kind of streets repaving do we foresee?
Well, what I want to do is a major effort to get all of the, you know, not all, let me not say all of the money, but most of the money, or a good portion of the money from the 1% up front, so that we can tackle, you know, many of the streets that you mentioned, if not all of the streets you mentioned. Right now, I'm waiting on a capital improvement plan that will be on my desk within a very short period of time. And from there, we already have money in hand in the 1% budget that we can start once we have that capital improvement plan. And then the other money we can leverage to go forward. So I can't announce to you right now what those streets are. I don't want to patronize you and tell you this is going to be a street when I don't know yet. And then I have to have the opportunity to push my particular thoughts on that issue and push the streets that I want to see fixed.
And let me say this when you're talking about this account, the accounting. I want to thank Supervisor Bobcat for coming out. He came down during the holiday, Christmas holiday camp, and brought me some food for the members that needed some food and was passing out food. And he couldn't hardly get out of my street. My street been like that for about 2 years. They came in and relined, put new pipes down there. That was in Harvey administration. And the streets were wopside and I had ditches and holes. I had people to bust tiles in. And Bobcat came down and he seen that these streets were so bad. Bobcat said, "Reverend, I'm going to fix your street. I'm going to," because the white people on the other end said, "Rev, let's get together and just fix it myself." Because we were tearing up too many tires. We were tearing up too many. And the police have that route every day. It's on their route that they have to come through that street. I'm looking on my cameras. Every day they make that route. So they know the pothole there. They can't hardly get through there. But a Supervisor Bobcat came down and fixed it good enough that we won't keep tearing up tires. But it still need a lot of more work, but I don't want to take my hats off to Bobcat.
Well, so your street's already thinner. Your street's already
No,
thinner.
It's not
thinner. No.
Okay, it's pothole.
What is your street?
It's Camilla Drive.
What is it?
Camilla Drive, right off of Savannah. And it's been like that for 2 or 3 years. When they dug the streets out, just like Councilman Stokes was talking about at the city council about Lindy Avenue, when they cut them out, they never come back and fix it. So if you can send some through there, just ride through and look. Bobcat only fix it enough to keep up some tearing up tile, because he said got to be a mutual agreement out with the city before they can go in and start working on folks' street. But he could, because that's his ward. He could fix that hole, and we thank him for doing that.
If I could say this, Pastor, and once again, let me thank you both gentlemen for the opportunity to speak on the program. Thank you again, and congratulate you again on the 26th year anniversary. What we have to do, when I'm talking about leveraging these dollars, Councilman Stokes, and I don't even know what your position is on this because we haven't talked about it. What I see is a $2.5 billion infrastructure problem, and we're receiving $13 million annually. One street could cost as much as $13 to $15 million. And so what we have to do is take that 1%, now that we have it, and use it as an asset, just like people's homes and their cars are assets, in order to leverage it, in order to put it on the market and get more money up front so that we can attack these streets. Some people believe that we need to let that money be used for maintenance down the road. Well, I think that maintenance is important, but we need to get to a point where our streets are well enough that they're in a condition to maintain it, right? And our streets are not there right now. Our streets are in a deplorable state, and we have to make a heavy investment for it. When you talk about the black businesses that are suffering in this community, when you talk about those businesses that we want to bring to this community, it's very difficult to do so when people avoid certain streets because of how bad they are. And so we have to turn our crumbling infrastructure into an economic frontier, and that requires an investment into our infrastructure, an investment into our streets. And that is what I am determined to do. And I want to do as much. I want to see the biggest paving effort that this city has.
Well, I tell you what, man, our time is done run out. And
before
again,
we go, I got to say about Washington, D.C., Rev, and y'all give us a little time, Brother Claude, you know, because we're going to talk about Washington, D.C. If you go into Washington, D.C., it's still running around Washington and Chicago, Coats and everything else. But there's a picture. Now, there's a statue in Washington, D.C., in front of City Hall of Mayor Marion Barry. A lot of people didn't know it. A lot of people didn't know that Mary Berry had a statue in front of City Hall, Washington, D.C., to make sure I went and stood and took a picture there so we can get into Jackson African. Young man for itty bitty. Well, he ain't a beena, miss. Itty bitty, he ain't a beena. But Mary Berry's in front of City Hall in Washington, D.C., ladies and gentlemen. We didn't get enough time to talk about
the governor wasn't in there from Killmonger, was it?
Who?
The governor. Our governor.
Which governor? Ain't he the one helped kill?
He went up there to Killmonger.
Then they killed Emmett Till, no. That's the same. Well, let me tell you this. We ran out of time. We hope you enjoyed our show. We had a guest with the mayor. And Harvey Johnson, they said some things about you. Boy, you better come up here and straighten up
your mind. That's right. Now, don't worry about it.
I'm just trying to figure out the nice that we talk.
Yeah, don't say just tell Harvey come on, because me and Harvey know we're going to talk about it, because I tried to get him not to do it. So, Harvey, you know, but I told you now. One thing about Harvey Johnson, y'all, and I told him that, and I tell him he was a politician. He was a politician. Now, he was up there with them white folks by getting things. You know, we had paved streets when Harvey was up there because he was a politician. We had a rock road over there on Manship, and Walter Payton, y'all don't know that. People talk about Walter Payton lived on Manship with my father across the street. When he left going to play with Chicago Bears, he left Manship was a rock road. But we found it, but at least we didn't have no hole, we had rock road. And it looked like May had to get a few more rocks. It'd be cheaper to get some rocks, just put some rocks on the road and get us stuff. But it's been a pleasure.
I'm going to change anniversary. It's today at 3 o'clock. I got to say I love your granny, Rita, Keith, Melissa, Kashawn, Keisha, Robert, Robin, Roman, Joseph, new baby boy, Kanita, Wolfrey, Deborah, Bobby, Dad, we had to go. Go ahead, Mr. Man, close it out.
Just end by saying that I have not said anything disparaging to Harvey Johnson. Harvey has his place cemented in our city's history. I did set the records straight on a few facts as to where contracts started. I think Harvey did his job for the city of Jackson, and now it's time that I do my job.
But I tell you what we're going to do, Kevin.
Today is my baby girl's birthday. I want to wish Alake happy 4th.
What's her name?
Alake.
That's right. I remember when you ran the first time. You was on the way back from when you have your wife check up. So now that's been 4 years.
And now we got another one.
Now you got one another one.
All right, Gospel Doctor, right. We saw winning your time, little bro. We got to go.
We got to get out of here. We're going to bring Harvey and the man back. I tell you what.
Hey, we'll find out.
They're going to be a weekend out of town.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
We got to go, y'all.
Bye-bye.
All right, we go. Brother Claude, take us out.
Gospel Doctor, we saw little bro winning your time.
He good. All right, Brother Claude, you're getting fitted too bad. Go home now. Hey, Brother Claude, before you leave, make sure you tell them to have somebody up there at 3 o'clock to get us on air.
Now, they already got it down. We on the air broadcasting live, right, Brother Claude? Yes, sir.
But we just need somebody to make sure.